Hey Fixsters, welcome to the tutorial of Python networking with sockets. I am Yogesh and I will be taking you through this course on networking with sockets. So let's begin. First, let's go through the contents and see what we plan to cover. We will start off with a small introduction and then we will see an IP, TCP IP stack overview. Then we will see what sockets are in the networking. Then we will go through the TCP IP client and server, and similarly we will go through a UDP IP client and server. So here is a small introduction of what exactly is TCP IP. So have you any time wondered what exactly happens in the system when you type app.fingster.com or google.com in your web browser and press an enter key? Or you are trying to send an email to friends sitting in Japan or Germany or India? This is what exactly we will be covering in Python networking. We will see how the data flows from an application like HTTP protocol, then through the IP or TCP IP protocol stack, then finally over the internet to fetch the data you requested. We will discuss in detail of how an IP stack looks like, followed by an overview of what exactly sockets are in networking. Then this will be a very interesting part of the course, where we will demo a hands-on thing using by setting up a TCP IP a client and server using a socket. And similarly we will demonstrate the same thing with UDP IP client and server. Let's now start with what TCP IP stack looks like. So here is the figure for the TCP IP stack. So this is how it comprises of different layers. So we will go through each layer one by one. A TCP IP stack is a four-decade old protocol, and it came into existence somewhere in 1975 or 80, and it is now regulated by a body called Internet Engineering Task Force, or short form IETF. So when we say a TCP/IP stack, it's also called as IP stack, and comprises of multiple protocols like HTTP, ICMP, ARP, FTP. So all these protocols are grouped together and they are commonly called as IP stack. Now we will go through each of these layers from bottom to top and try to peel them one by one. So what is exactly network access layer? So network access layer is this layer here. This is the bottommost layer. It's also called as link layer or layer 2, and it comprises mostly of Ethernet frames, or IEEE 802.3 is another name for Ethernet frames. So this layer mostly would comprise of Ethernet driver for your network card, and also comprises of protocols like ARP or address resolution protocol for local area network communication. So what exactly is ARP can be explained something like this. So if you can see the figure here, we have multiple PCs, two or more PCs connected over the LAN cable, and this becomes local area network. It is not connected to the internet. So when two PCs are communicating over LAN, the actual IP routing part of the router is not involved. The router behaves like a switch. The PC will generate PCs will generate Ethernet frames with something called as MAC addresses or media access control addresses, and they will pass through this switching part of the router and communicate with each other. So this is where the networking layer comes into picture. And that's why it is called layer 2. Layer 1 will be mostly your physical cable, like here, the cable seen here, this blue color, this is the LAN cable or Ethernet cable. This becomes your layer 1. This is where physically the bits are transmitted over, and you are connected to either internet or intranet, in other words, internet or local area networks. What we will now discuss is internet layer, also called as internet protocol or layer 3. This is the most important layer in the stack, because this is where routing happens. So what is the responsibility of this layer? The layer is mostly involved in sending data from host to destination. So when I say routing, it means having multiple intermediate hops or devices between two endpoints of communication, and these are communicating using something called as IP header. So what is an IP header? IP header, for example, is nothing but a sequence of bytes used in IP protocol. So every protocol has a header, and header is nothing but a sequence of bytes which define how the protocol should behave. So in case of IP protocol, we have IP header, and there are again here two types of headers. One is IP version 4 and IP version 6. In IP version 4, we have 4 bytes of source and destination address, as compared to IPv6, which has 16 bytes of source and destination address. So whenever you are sending data from, say, host 1 to another host 2, then the source will fill the source IP address and the destination IP address and send the packet to the destination, and it may not reach the destination within one hop, which means, for example, you are in Australia and trying to send an email to your friend in Japan, then there may not be a single hop possible. So it goes through multiple hops. So the packet gets transmitted something like this. You can say there are multiple intermediate routers, also called as gateways. So this is like hop 1, hop 2, it continues like that. There may be n hops before it reaches the packet from the source to destination and then back. And there are many multiple algorithms involved here in routing, which choose the shortest path for transmitting the data from the source to destination. We do not have to know every detail of every bit and byte used here, because this is just already implemented for you as part of the operating system layer somewhere inside the kernel, where you have all these bytes available. So whenever you send data from your application, the lower layers inside the operating system add this protocol header and then send the data to the destination. So here, when I say, as I said, like IPv4 has 32 bits or 4 bytes, and IPv6 has 128 bits or 16 bytes. The main advantage of IPv6 is that you can address more nodes with that, like 2^16 nodes is possible to address. So which means we can have multiple billions of devices connected to the internet. So this is the whole idea behind what Internet of Things, where you have like very small sensor devices connected to the internet. So why? This is because of IPv6, which can accommodate billions of devices. And now one example of IP address would be something like this. Like here you can see 192.168.1.1 or 1.4. So this is an example of an IP address. This is an example of IPv4. What we will discuss now is transport layer, and transport layer comprises of mostly two protocols. One is called TCP or Transmission Control Protocol, and the other is UDP or User Datagram Protocol. So what we are talking about is mostly this layer here. Both exist in parallel and are part of transport layer. So you can choose, so the application is free to choose either TCP or UDP. And the difference between TCP and UDP is that TCP is connection oriented, which means that when we have two devices connected, then the connection stays as long as you want it to stay, and when you terminate, then only the connection terminates. Whereas UDP is not connection oriented, it is a connection less protocol, so there is no kind of formal connection between the server and the client. So it's just exchange of data and that's it. So TCP is connection oriented in the sense like there is all the time some kind of acknowledgement going on between the server and the client. So this that is the reason why TCP is very reliable and it guarantees delivery compared to UDP, which does not guarantee any delivery. However, there are a lot of applications which need faster data delivery, and for which UDP is very useful. So this is when UDP is used. Another use case of UDP is in IoT protocols such as CoAP and MQTT, which are using UDP as the transport layer for communication because of faster delivery. The next one is the application layer. This is where your browsers and the email like Microsoft Outlook or your Gmail operate, and they use protocols like HTTP or FTP or SMTP, etc., which make use of the transport layer like TCP or UDP for delivering the data. So application layer is mostly here. So you can use, so for example, your browser sits here. It's making use of HTTP, for example. The next most important thing for networking is sockets. And what are sockets? Sockets are basically help to establish point-to-point communication communication between a client and a server. So they basically help to contact between processes either on the same or on distant machines. Internally, a socket makes use of the capabilities of operating system. So for example, in case of Python, which implements sockets as a module, internally the sockets module makes use of operating system calls, or which we also call it as system calls, to interact with the TCP/IP stack. So for example, in case of Linux, it may use system calls like epoll or select to talk to the Linux kernel, which implements the TCP/IP stack. Similarly, for Windows and Mac, there will be system calls available to interact with the TCP/IP stack, which is part of the kernel. And socket is similar like a file descriptor in Unix machines. So you have some kind of a socket ID, which is an integer value, and it is similar to how file descriptors in Unix. So basically you can write, read data from the socket. So now classification of sockets. So basically you can have sockets for TCP and sockets for UDP. So for TCP we call it a stream because it is connection oriented, and for UDP we call it as datagram. Also you can classify sockets based on IP addressing. So for example, in case of IPv4 addresses we call it as AF-INET, and for IPv6 addresses we call it as AF-INET 6. So the Python socket module provides all the interfaces to write UDP and client UDP and TCP clients and servers. So which means we do not have to worry too much about what internally the socket module does. It is a completely abstracted from the user. So we have to only worry about the APIs, what the socket module gives us, and internally whether it talks to the operating system in through system calls or through any other mechanisms. We do not have to much worry about it. It's completely abstracted for us. So what is a server? A server represents an application waiting for a connection by a client, and client represents an application which connects to the server. So now let me demonstrate the socket with a small diagram here. So it's something like this. So you have a machine A and this is your machine B. So they are two remote machines. So you have one process or thread running here. You have similarly one process or thread running here which is using socket. So both are connected over TCP protocol. The socket makes use of TCP, and over the network they are communicating over the internet. So if you see here, socket is making use of TCP, and this TCP internally we don't know. For example, in operating systems it's part of the operating system. So we are mostly concerned with using sockets for communication. So how do we now go through some of the socket APIs which are commonly used? We don't have to remember this because it's just available and we can go through the documentation and get more details. So it's just I have collected here some important APIs like socket.socket will create a socket for you. So here we are creating a stream kind of socket, that is a TCP kind of socket for IPv4. Then we can receive data using receive, and here we need to pass, for example, buffer length, how much data we want to receive. Receive from is where it's used in case of UDP, where we are going to receive data for the given buffer length, and we have to pass also the address to get the data. Similarly, there are other APIs like receive into, directly into the buffer, receive from, into, then send to send the data now. So if you want to send the data, then you use either send or you use send to. This is usually used in case of UDP. And finally, this is important, closing the socket so that it releases the memory. So when you are done with your socket communication, it's very important that you close the socket so that you release the memory. Now comes the most interesting part, where we will demonstrate the actual TCP IP client and server. This will be a very simple client and server where we exchange some small data. So I'll first take you through the logic, and then we will actually see live by running the code. So basically the TCP is a connection oriented protocol. So first we need to establish some kind of connect with the client. So and as I also mentioned, that sockets can be used for communicating with the machines either remotely or on the same machine. So because I want to demonstrate both the client and the server, so I have chosen my machine as localhost, where you will run both the server and client. So I choose an IP address of 127.0.1, which represents the local host. The port number I choose as 9998. You are free to choose any other port number, provided it lies in the TCP IP port range. There are some fixed ports which you cannot use, like for example 80 is used for HTTP, so you cannot use this particular IP port for setting up server and client. So I'm just choosing some random number, 9998, and we first create a socket of type stream, and then it's of type IPv4, so I'm choosing AF-INET. So once the socket is created here, so we created a server socket. Now you can bind the socket. So basically bind is telling the socket that I am basically binding to this particular IP address and this particular port. So since my IP and port are the local host, are for the local host, I pass the same server IP and server port. So in case of remote, then you have to get you should know your IP address of your machine, and then pass that server IP and the port. Next is to listen for incoming connections. Here it accepts a parameter called number of connections. So I passed it as 10. So here, which means I can maximum take 10 number of connections from the clients. So next we come here to accepting the incoming connection. So before that, I will explain what is called a blocking call. A blocking call is somewhere where it blocks until some action happens. So server accept, for example, is a blocking call. So you will be waiting here until the client connects. So as soon as the client connects, then you will get the client's socket ID and host and the port. So in this case, we wait for the connection, and let's assume if the client connects, then we know the socket client ID. Now we can start receiving the data from the client. So we will use, for example, socket client dot receive. I have passed it as 1024. You can choose any data length you want to receive, and then I'm just printing out the data. And finally, now I am sending back some data to the client, telling him that, hey, I received data from you, thanks. And here sending and receiving always happens for example here in terms of bytes, which means whenever you are sending the data, you have to send it not as a string here, for received data is in the form of string, but rather we should convert it into bytes, because it will be because the network accepts only sequence of bytes and not string. It does not understand what string is. So basically your string is converted into bytes, and we will use the usual format used for transmission is UTF-8. So we will use here UTF-8, and once the communication is done, now you can close the server socket. You could also choose to close the client socket, because there is nothing much to do. However, this client socket was not created by us, so it will just get automatically taken up, relinquished by the operating system. In case of server, we are explicitly closing the communication. So it's simple. We first just create the socket, bind, listen, and then we accept the incoming connection from the client. Similarly, let's go through the client code. It's much more simpler. I have implemented it in a very simple way, that it will just connect to the server and send some data. Here we know that we are always binding on the local stuff, right? For the demonstration, so we will localhost has 127.0.1 and 9988. In case you have a remote client, so then you have to choose, then you have to give the appropriate IP address of the server. So again, we create a client socket here, and we just here the sequence of steps are first connect to the server and then start and send the sending the data. So as I mentioned, when we send the data, we have to convert it into bytes, because we cannot send the string directly. We rather use a sequence of bytes which have to be sent over the network. And then we, once the client sends the data, we are also receiving some data if the server sends. So here we have sent him some data to the client, and on the same I am receiving some data now. So I send the data, and on the same socket I can receive the data which came from the server. And then finally we close the connection, because we are no longer now want to communication to proceed. So yeah, this is how the TCP IP client, server and client work. Now let's live demonstrate it. So here we have the, you can see the same code here. I just copied it here to some Python file, and I have my TCP server and TCP client. So I will just run it. So what we will do is, it will, you can check here, it will wait for the connection. So if I run it, you can see the server is waiting for a connection. Now as soon as I execute client code, you can see exchange, it connects to the server and then exchange data. So if I run now the client, yeah, you can see here. So if I go to the output of server, it was waiting for connection, then it received hello from client. And here I after receiving, server sent some data back, and this was received by the client here. I received data, thanks. This B you see is because of I use this bytes. If you don't want that, then it's possible to just discard that bytes, this B character. It's not necessary that it should be passed. You can always discard it when you receive the data from the server or from the client. So at both ends you can just discard the data as soon as you receive. This B can be discarded. So yeah, so this is how it works, the TCP client and server. Now this is what I explained here was very simple. Now we are sending here, because we are sending the data and sending the data only once here, sending and receiving it only once. But if you wish to send or receive large amounts of data, then you need to put some kind of a while loop here in both client and server. Or you can also use threads or multi-threading, where you can start communicating with client and server. So basically you have to, here in receiving and accept, you have to put a while loop. You have to keep polling for accept input connections. Similarly here you have to keep in a while loop and keep exchanging data. So yeah, this is how the communication works in TCP/IP. So next is the UDP client and server. Because UDP is not connection oriented, and it's in terms of datagrams, so we don't have to establish a connection here between client and server like TCP. So we do not have listen and accept APIs to be used for UDP server and client. Otherwise most of the things are very similar, so I will not go through everything again, but I will just explain quickly some important steps. I again the same localhost, so I have 127.0.0.1 and then some port. Then I create a socket and bind to that server IP and port. And next, here we do not have listen and accept, but rather we can receive from client. So whenever the client sends any data, we just collect that data. And now we know with this API receive from, we will get to know the address of the client from whom we have received the data. So if there are five clients communicating with the server, so each client will have a separate address. So every time we know the address of which client is communicating with us, so we can send back. So if you want to send back any data back, we can use the same address which we received. So for example, here once I receive the data, I am now server.send to, and again I use the bytes because we want to send not only just a string but rather a sequence of bytes. And then I send some data here, I am the UDP server, thanks. And send to accepts also the address to whom which we want to communicate to. So this address, whatever was received, address of the client which we received, can be used to send back the data to the client, to the respective client. And then finally we are done with the communication, so we can close. Always a good practice, because then it releases all the memory. Similarly, client, again we are going through a localhost, we want to communicate with 6769 port. We again create a socket, this time again of type datagram. So here also, this is very important, we create a type of datagram, this is UDP socket. Similarly here we are creating a UDP socket, and then we just create a, we just put the server IP and address as a server IP and the server port in this address variable, and then directly call send to, and then I send the data to this address, to the server address. And then whatever the server sent, we can again receive the same here using socket client.receive from, and record the server response. So once we get the server response, we can just print it out. This address you will receive will be the address of the server. Like here you received the address of the client, here you will receive again the address of the server. And finally we close the socket. So let's quickly run this as a live demo. So here you will see the my UDP server and my UDP client. I just try to run it. So run, and then initially there is nothing because it's in the receive from, it's in the blocking call. Here it's receive from is a blocking call, so it waits here for the client for the client to give some data. So now if you see, if I run client, it will receive the data and then there is exchange. So run the client. Yeah, you can see here in the server I had received the data hello from UDP client, and on the on the client side you can see server responded saying I am the UDP server, thanks for the data. So yeah, so this is how a simple UDP server and client can be implemented. Yeah, again you can use a while loop if you want to continuously send data streams, or use some kind of a threading again where you can exchange data continuously between client and server. So lastly, some final words. So we saw in this tutorial what Python sockets are for TCP and UDP, and the best example of a TCP usage is something like email or P2P application, And for UDP, for example, say a video streaming application. And we also reviewed the sockets for networking. We implemented the TCP IP and UDP IP clients and servers as real life use cases. So what you can do is you can create your own chat application using client and server by using some kind of a while loop. So you can continuously keep looping, use input from the user on the terminal, and then use that to send the data between client and server. So you can implement some kind of a while loop, continuously exchange of data between client and server. You can also further explore by setting up your own HTTP server and client and exchange the data with no browser. So Python code to implement HTTP server and HTTP client, which will internally make use of TCP IP APIs. That is basically the socket APIs. Hope this blog gives you a head start for networking in Python, because networking is a very huge topic with lot of use cases and lot of applications and lot of protocols. So it's very difficult to cover everything, but at least this is I believe a good beginning, and I hope that you get some insights into networking in Python. So for further networking APIs, you can always visit the standard official python.org socket.html. Okay, thank you.